And now, let me introduce you the one who have been the inner motor of IAAC in the last years, the catalyzer of ideas and projects day by day with her energy, her passion, and her vision, the academic director of the Institute for Advanced Architecture of Catalonia, Areti Markopoulou.
Thank you so much. And good afternoon from my side as well to all of you, to faculty and students, to collaborators and friends. Today we are opening our lecture series with our special guest Winy Maas, but as every year we take this opportunity and this opening moment to inaugurate our master's and postgraduate programs. So on the one hand, I would like to welcome Winy Maas, principal of MVRDV, architect, urban designer, landscape architect, but more than that, a visionary professional, and as Manuel very well said, a very good and old friend of IAAC. So Winy, thank you very much for being here with us today. And I would also like to welcome our 110 students that they are standing here and they are coming from 41 different countries around the world. Allow me to name the countries one by one. I always like to do that because I think it is part, this multicultural identity is part of the objectives of IAAC, and it's something that we really much force and induce. So let us get there. Australia.
Yay! Yay!
Lebanon. Italy. Greece. The Greeks are Greeks? Where are the Greeks? Thank you, Greeks. Turkey, Romania, Denmark, Germany, Bulgaria, Austria, Poland, Netherlands, Russia, Kazakhstan, Israel, Iran, Bosnia, Serbia, Colombia, Mexico, Brazil, Peru, Ecuador, Venezuela, Bolivia, Canada, USA, China, Japan, Indonesia, Thailand, Malaysia, Filipinas, Vietnam, Maldives, Egypt, Jordan, Angola, South Africa, and finally, India. So, students from 41 countries, they are gathering here today searching for advanced architecture, research, knowledge, and innovation. But more than that, searching for exchange, understanding, making, and sharing. And this is exactly what we have created here at IAAC for you. A research and educational open platform, developing not only the visions, but also the tools for the 21st century process of architecture and habitability. The IAAC Masters and Postgraduate Programs emerge as innovative educational structures focusing on new ideas for future cities and buildings, self-sufficiency, digital manufacturing techniques, advanced interaction, and information technologies. This research is led by local and internationally renowned experts and faculty, and our goal at IAAC is, together with the faculty and the students, shape the future of architecture, cities, and technology. The IAAC approach towards advanced architecture is based on two crucial strategies: the importance of acting on multiple scales and the necessity for the integration of multiple disciplines. So we are incorporating in our teaching and project realization projects that start from material nanoscale exploration to building design, from sensors and physical computing to the strategic development of master plans, from individuals to the global community, from beach to geography. Additionally, we develop our programs and research in close collaboration with specialists from diverse fields. We're working with biologists and engineers, to arborists and permaculturers, from architects and designers, to anthropologists and sociologists, from programmers and manufacturers, to economists, I see some back there, and policymakers. So our educational model is based on learning out of making. Process is as important as the continuously evolving goals. Furthermore, our structure allows flexibility towards the integration of new relevant topics. We are small, and this allows us to be really flexible. And we feel this to be central to the program's development, as our students, at the end of the day, they are part of one of the most infocentric and rapidly adapting and mobile generations. We, as faculty, we do not just teach what we know. We wish to learn more together with our students, experts, and collaborators. We work collectively as a research team to establish and promote our knowledge and together explore new fields, sometimes probably with no existing references, but always we're doing so with a clear vision, with scientific experiments, and with intuition. The master program projects embody the commitment of IAAC to merge basic research with applied research. Through our educational programs, we materialize our ideas. We are testing pilot projects, we apply innovative solutions, and we respond to the current needs of society, always basing this on the means of the latest technology available and the knowledge offered by diverse disciplines. In a profession such as architecture, where it is important to know if new ideas are supported over time and at a larger scale, it is fundamental to test the processes, technologies or fabrication solutions, the software and hardware incentive systems, and finally, the implementation arrangement. This is why we're glad to count on the expertise of the industry and integrate this into the academic and research environment. Thanks to the support and dedication of an incredible range of collaborative companies as well as institutions, all specialized in diverse fields. IAAC is small, independent, and a global hub of envisioners. And of course, it is located in Barcelona, a city with an amazing richness of history and culture, a reference of technology, innovation, and humanism. That is the perfect place to be. Barcelona is the perfect place to host IAAC's non-stop engine of energy and activities. Together with the City Council of Barcelona, as well as with local institutions and associations, as well as professionals and individuals, we work together to set up the basis for being the pioneers in the transformation of our current and future cities. We wish to define how the architects will influence the way we live, interact, and communicate in the new global contexts. As part of being in Barcelona, we are committed to develop new categories of projects, solutions, and technologies that can be extended systematically into other cities of the world, thus helping them to become more efficient and more human. I wish to close highlighting the importance of the huge IAAC community spread all over the world. The master's alumni community counts with more than 650 alumni in 70 different countries around the world, more than 100 local and international faculty and collaborators, and of course partnerships with numerous leading international companies and institutions. This community is contributing to the fact that IAAC now is in a process of growing and opening up to more challenges. We are setting up new master's and PhD programs focused on cities and technology. We are working on new projects for urban transformations and sustainable building prototypes in India and China. We are contributing to the implementation of the tools of digital fabrication as a citizen-based service in the Fab City of Barcelona. All this, understanding that the new challenges in architecture lie in the capacity of the transformation of cities through the integration of technologies, fabrication, and innovative design. So we wish to welcome you all to the IAAC community, and we invite each one of you and all together to participate, exchange, and propose. Thank you very much for being here today.
Thanks, Arete, for your inspiring words. And now it's an honor to welcome our special guest for tonight. Welcome in Barcelona, welcome in our house, in our warehouse, in our laboratory, in our school, in this weird, dirty, cold space full of ideas, full of people. Very weird place, but for this special and for this really productive. Our guest of tonight is Winy Maas, as you all know, and let me read some few words about his biography. Winy Maas is one of the co-founding directors of the globally operating architecture and urban planning firm MVRDV, based in Rotterdam, Netherlands, known for projects such as the Expo 2000 and the vision for Greater Paris, Grand Paris Petit Plus. He's furthermore professor and director of the Y Factory, a research institute for the future city he founded in 2008 at TU Delft. Since 2013, he's visiting professor at the University of Hong Kong. Before that, among other, professor at ETH Zurich, Berlage Institute, MIT, Ohio State, and Yale University. In addition, he designed stage sets, objects, and was curator of Indesem 2007. Recently, Winy Maas joined the Economic Development Board of Rotterdam. In 2012, he was appointed urban supervisor for the city of Almere, and since 2003, he has been supervising the Bjorvika urban development in Oslo. He curates, beside that, exhibition, lectures throughout the world, and takes part in international juries. And today is here among us. Winy Maas.
It works. Ladies and gentlemen, dear Manuel, dear Aretti, it's nice to be here with you for the first time since 11 years. So it's you have opened it 11 years ago and I never came back. So stupid. And because I think it's an incredible, when I listen to your starting speeches, that UPC must be honored with such an initiative. And I think it's very good that you did that, that you have started with such a kind of element which is uncertain and has another kind of domain. I'm aware that politically in Barcelona, with fighting universities and fighting directions, that that's a courageous step as far as I can judge. And somehow it should be enlarged, and that takes me even more courage to do that. And somehow we are brothers and sisters, I'm aware. And at the end of my speech, I will come back to that. And somehow, after this afternoon's walk through your house, your warehouse, I'm happy to share, hopefully in the future, more with you. And because these days, the competition is everywhere. And it's the crisis in Europe has caused not only between architects a lot of competition, but all over the world. One could say there are too many architects, there are maybe too much inventors, but we lost our industries. They went to Asia and to India, and we put maybe a lot in our service domains. But we wonder how can we survive? And at the moment, yes, we are all fighting for the same funds at the European Union. We are all fighting for the same students at somehow. And we are all fighting for the same budgets from our universities. And how can we proceed is the question of tonight in that way, as a starting of your year. So what can I contribute to tonight? Is it somehow for you that starts in this institution, what's happening here? Somehow this is weird. Yeah, there it is. Is to look a little, not too much back, but to look to what we are doing now. But I want to still, this is what we made 11 years ago here with Akhtar, with some of my friends, the thickest book that I could imagine at that moment, to give everything to the planet. But of course we should discuss what's afterwards in that way. And I use that in a way to discuss with you tonight somehow what is progress, or what is the next step in any, and how can we conceive that? You're trying to do that here in somehow. And some of these last 10 years also is a little bit about that. Of course, what's next is a title that has been given so beautifully by Time magazine, when he died. So this dying act is on one hand beautiful and horrible, was it what actually, and that's the sensation that architecture needs to have. We are always needs to be edgy, and that's between beauty and horror, and I will come back to that somehow in this lecture more. Because normally we are only about beauty, and I think we have to look at a bit carefully to that. Because beauty only, wow, that's actually super boring, and that's and doesn't help only in that way. So what is then this, what did we do after KM3 in that way? Well, maybe you remember just a small word, what this is about. It was a story. This was a story about the capacity of the planet and the capacity of our brains, of our architecture as such. So it was looking to and filming maps over the planet and looking to cities that grow and expand and produce this kind of shit and endlessly any city. It could be Mexico City, where are you? Or it could be in that way Tokyo, 99%, as also is beautifully explained after 10 years by Frank Gehry last week, and in the press, yeah, it took him a while, and to say that indeed that production we have to face. But how can we, what can we do with that? What is then advancedness in that way, as you are proclaiming in your institute, in your constitution, I must say. So that moment, of course, we try to understand a little bit that the scale of that operation, of this capacity, and find out what is enlarging our domain and what is reducing our domain. And there are many phenomena in that way. There is the forests that are disappearing, there is deserts that are growing, that are cities that are growing, there are desires to work in leisure is growing, and Costa Iberica was one of them. And somehow we needed to measure that. This was the birthplace here in Barcelona about the ecological footprint at that moment. And to measure our activities and to compensate that by some kind of other kind of alternatives. So the built production was like, I tried to find out, can we measure ourselves? And of course we compare always ourselves to the US, because you went there last week, and in order, because we'd be very highly intimidated by the research tours. But anyway, if we behave like Americans, then we can still compensate that with architecture. So what is architecture on that moment? And that is like a tool to somehow understand a little bit that production. And what can then that be? And we, at that moment, described architecture as verbs. And to say, in the best tradition of Akhtar, to say that they are activators. And so we followed you and said, what can we do? What kind of activations can we have? And I take you to, of course, one of them that we acknowledged at that moment. And in order that every building can help to enlarge the capacity of our planets. So that's a contradiction. You produce something, but you add something also. So density is nice, one could say, but yeah, is it all? Is it everything? So one of the small techniques that we have in architecture was coming up in those years, 10 years ago, that you we produce housing these days, and but a house next door, you should not hear your neighbor, so we make our walls 25 centimeters thick, and then you need, structurally, I only need 14 centimeters, so 11 centimeters, what can I do with that? I can use that to span, and to make gratuitely like spaces for the public with that, and enlarge, say, the at that moment, that even if I'm in a denser, intenser environment, that I still can be anti-claustrophobic. And that's actually one of the elements. So what was next, and that took us then 10 years in Rotterdam last week, somehow, when I look back to that book, and we're like saying, could we do that? And I would like to show you that story for a minute. So that's Rotterdam. It used to be like that, and in that very heart of that old city, where some Germans did this to that city and flattened out, we are asked to look at it. So Rotterdam is not like Barcelona, of course, can never beat. We don't want Rotterdam. Because I think it's good to find somehow kind of authenticity in any city to develop. And what can that then be without becoming overproud and introvert, if not incestuous? So in this case, Rotterdam is like about like space. It makes, there's giant spaces and it puts something there, a building from the 80s, the 70s. Every time it tried to reinvent itself. And in the meantime, they didn't conquer that space. So what can we do on that spot that was too big? The largest, say, space of Europe, 1.6 kilometer long, 200 meter wide. It's bigger than the Red Square in Moscow. So what can we then add to that? So it was at this competition, and the developers came to us and said, yeah, we want to have these houses, and on either side, 250, and then like a market hall in between, and it would be something like Miralles. So learning from Vegas, say Barcelona, is what we then had to do. I said, no, but this is horrible, because it was the momentum that food became sexy. Now it's already done. But in that moment, for the northern European countries, it was a very important thing to solicitate to a kind of covered market that you normally can find in Valencia or in Barcelona. So what can we do to make it more monumental? Okay, let's flip it. And then, now we have a space. And the client said, maybe you're right, but it's expensive. No, I said, you can make here more penthouses, the penthouses don't have a view in that way. Said, okay, we do it. And we get here this view. And then he said, but here in this case, I need so much steel, and that cost me too much money. I said, okay, maybe look again to Roma and made them this kind of arch. And then he said, but a nice solution to save money, but then where's the lift in that way? So, okay, we push it back, and then basically the building was done. So this is Dutch technology to make. We have tunnels, put concrete over it, pull the tunnel out, put it up again, and at a certain moment, 1 meter, 1 meter, 1 meter, you can kiss each other, and then you have gratuitously, as I said before, a kind of space in that way. So, this is it, anyway, and then we can only look, basically, the outside, it's now covered with the tiles of Rotterdam that go over it, and then we go to the inside, because that's what it is about. You give a passage, and you give a place where you can have a market in that way, say, gratuitously, and you make a kind of advertisement screen with LEDs and initially, and where you can open it up, and from your kitchens, you can throw a hook down, and then get the fish up, or say to your son, please come, we have food now together. So pop is then becoming part of our architectural domain. And somehow it was like an intention that even social of lower middle class housing can also lead to monumentalism. In a moment that our Calatravas and other confreres were like only using museums and cultural institutions to do that. So that was our intention to do, and then of course, that comes this in, and we make a frame of the beauty of Rotterdam on both sides. And you see the collection of nostalgia that is then in Rotterdam there, that somehow is celebrated by this new space. So here you see it happening in a quick film, get rid of a building there, make another school there, start to dig, and then there the building is coming up, growing, with indeed our and gorgeous scenes at a certain moment to make this pushing act. We didn't have enough money at the moment for the LCD screen. Even Philips was trying to do that as a local partner. And so we ended up with a moment in that the developer said, okay, I don't have a screen, put some aluminum against it. I said, no, let's not do that. Let's then organize one frozen picture and let's make that as if you are in Wonderland, showing this perspective. But that's too expensive. So we had to prove that burning gigabytes could be solved, in this case with a Japanese technique, and that ultimately it could be paid and leads now to a kind of environment where you live behind the dahlia, live behind the strawberry, or are added to the escargot. And then any element becomes dramatic in such a space. Like even a cleaning machine is then suddenly like a place where you could play opera, and that somehow wants to do an advertisement act for that food. So of course it points further. I mean, there's an X-ray of the houses. It's an X-ray of the city that we present. And the most important feature, I think, of that building is this. the window. Because with the window, I can, with anyone that buys an apartment, from this one owned, he owns that perspective. He owns the neighbor on the other side, he owns the market, and any, I mean, the private market is not like in Spain where it's a collective instrument. The private guy will never say, occupy that space in his own way. There's a responsibility forced, one could say, almost in a Dutch way, because we believe in force. But more beautiful are the houses at that moment, because they get corridors, you can sit on the toilet and look outside immediately to the market, or this is then the view that we were constructing, or this is a bedroom, my favorite bedroom, and where your pillow is then actually the piece of glass, and that way you can look down then, or get and have fantastic dreams, or maybe nightmares, depending on your view, and then look to that kind of, that was the union construction, and this is one of my favorite windows. In one of the houses, there are a couple of them, where if you go up, then this is in the middle of your house, so that, say, your kids are playing Lego on 40 meter plus. And what you normally, in Toronto, it's fine on 500 in the tower, but in that way, if you do that in your house, beauty and horror are kissing each other at that moment, is what they are saying, and here you see it happening. At any place, you have these windows that somehow show themselves. And then we, because of the European laws, we have to finish the passage with a temporary glass. So we make some wires and then hang glass to it. But that became more serious because in the end, because the wind will go like this, and then we have now tennis rackets that somehow have a bending factor of, say, 2 meters on either end. And that has to be reinforced by this kind of, say, machines to make that possible. What is happening at that moment when constructing? Then suddenly people start to see it, and that that doesn't happen always in architecture. And that, say, newspapers are going there, they send out people to talk with people. What is the good thing about architecture? Does it help? They start to predict that because of this building, Rotterdam has now like 350,000 tourists. And then would lead to 400,000 the coming year, and we were and it was already proudly announced in the Rough Guide and in the Times, the New York Times, that that because of this building, suddenly you should go there is what they and then our queen wake up. And she said, then I want to come also. And so there she comes, and she opened our building, and we are sitting here together. And of course, this is so beautiful. This is like Cinderella and with Maxima, and to where she of course, this is typically developers that somehow want to have this kind of scenery. But it helped. It was she went on the floor outside. This was happening, and it became larger and larger. And then the doors started to become open at that moment. People started to come in, and we had to close the doors half an hour later because the fire, we didn't make a good and proper calculation of the people that were in there, and that say there were like 20 times as much, and the building has adopted immediately. So this is what now happens, and this is my friend who we went to your country, and this is not like Harrods or something that we wanted to do, the food court. No, the blood has to go over the floor, and from pigs also, yes, and so that in that way it becomes a vivid place. And of course, then also the people come in, and they start to observe the market. They look outside to the city. They sleep next to that situation. They go further from their bedroom. And look deeper to what's happening over there. And even when you go up and look from stairs and any situations in that building, you are part of it. And this is then, say, the screen for the babies and for the Lego kids that somehow are now celebrated in this building. And somehow it is there. It is simple. It's a free space done by social and lower middle class housing that started not only to activate itself, but somehow also the plaza before, and maybe even the city in its way. And yes, it was very proud to that. Yeah, in 1 week time, we had 1 million visitors. And so that this like 50,000 is like ridiculized immediately in 1 week time, and that we are that it's busier than in Euro Disney is also like a funny coincidence. So yes, KM3 became Gotika. What's next? And took indeed like a moment of realization in that way, and got that attention that maybe you would like to dream about. But what's next? So I take you for this moment to our drawing situation, and I take you to Amsterdam. Like there is on that place, we are working on the new tennis courts, and that's under production over there, as you can see here, where we paint everything red, just to start with that. And then, of course, we have to build our tribunes and our amenities in that way. So that's on this spot. We start with the first amenity, so the clubhouse, where we open it up to do two views. And remember, I was talking about spans. So this span is... so what we did, basically, on the knowledge of Alvaro Siza, is to twist Siza in such a way that we can make a hanger and a stacker in the same moment. And this combination, that is easily be done with your technology, then leads to this kind of seat or this couch that overlooks now the tennis court. So like a small element, it has this kind of appearance as such. And yes, it is buildable and it's overcoming up at the moment. So from the market hall to the next step, a hanger or a spanner as a kind of small element in Amsterdam is a step that I would like to take to you. And what is next then in that way? And I take you to another verb. Where is it? To the mixers over there. Yes, you were saying that this was done in 2000 and we stacked these pieces and made even a forest inside as a kind of conviction to you and to all people to make it possible to believe that that density could be doable. But what is next after that stacking enterprise is that this building became suddenly a dystopia after a moment of utopia. And now it is flooded with birds and hippies that are squatting this tower, and that it becomes. But it is a monument, acknowledged as a monument. So I'm very proud that we could build a monument. But what to do with it in an area where labor employment went down to 25%, where the whole Expo has turned into a kind of Nagasaki-like environment, and where then which is where this, but also in a kind of beauty in the best tradition of Goethe. Or of the romanticism of the Germans, where ruinism is certainly a beauty as such. So with proud I show this. This is part of our reality in the what's nextness. What's next is unpredictable? No. You test things to the extreme, and then there's two ways to go to. Or you ruinize it, or you go further. And so this is one of the elements that I would like to show. So what's next in that way? And yes, that was done, of course, here, that we did this building and to make this kind of stacker where this soccer field somehow was floating over Madrid to, and someone was saying that Madrid is cute and nice with all these blocks, endless series of blocks, but a flip block is better because then you have a view. And I was so happy that your mayor at that moment said, yes, it's fine, very good, and that you accept criticism. I think your culture is fantastic as long as you accept criticism. That's what I think this institute is about. That's what you are organizing here, a kind of self-criticism. And with that self-criticism, we come much further than if we don't, and only otherwise it would lead to protectionism. So the mayor was happy, and he said, okay. Now the next time you make a real block and not a flip block. So he liked it, and then we in that realized, next to that, this Celosia block, where we simply stacked some social housing and then have views through it so that you indeed from your bathroom can look to further neighbor so that the patio becomes vivid and not enclosed. That's so stupid. Sorry. And then to have this kind of environment that lead to endless gardens everywhere. And of course then you can say this and you start to wonder, didn't I see that before? Yes, 50 years ago Le Corbusier wanted to make that building and he couldn't. So now you, your Spanish culture, with your social housing budgets, were able to do that. That's fantastic that you did it. And I will come back to that issue of, say, misusing Le Corbusier or others in that what's nextness. And of course, I'm happy to announce the Jakarta project, but where, say, in a very flat city at the moment, because of the MTR that's coming in, based on the new kind of ideologies of your new president, wow, love him, I would say, and how this is then coming up. So I take you to this flattest city on the planet that's basically composed out of blocks and small elements, kampungs, mill villages, and how to make then a density on that spot, on the former rupiah factory that should turn from a money base into a new element. So here you see the environment with the blocks and the small entities that are over there. So here with Jordi, we try to imagine and say somehow like a density that's composed out of that element. And how and what kind of logic is there? Now, I take you to the film to explain that for a minute. There it is. Give me a second. So, that's Jakarta, flat as a pancake. With all its problems of infrastructure, etc. Here the spot that I was referring to. So there are some first towers appearing, but still very cute. So what to do? You make some big pavement, make a connection with the metro, keep monuments as the mosque and this one, dig a hole, put a shopping center in, make retail as dispersed as possible, also do that the same with all the culture, and do that the same with all the neighborhoods of housing, offices, and top it up with a boutique hotel. Well, then you clad it with architecture, put a lot of, say, water and vegetation on top of it, and a wind can blow through it and filter the air. An open mall. And then suddenly this kind of stuff is culminating and wants to ask a question about that city, but also gives an answer towards the patronas in a neighboring Malaysia, or to compete somehow with 101 in Taipei. So there it goes, all these different neighborhoods. And from no angle it's the same. Okay, we go inside. There is like a trajectory that spans from one address to the other. I can point out where I live, or where I want to work. So you travel over the IMAX, next to Soho. Pass by the Sawa houses. And further up to this kind of oasis. We're in the World Trade Center. And in the boutique hotel, and bang, that's it. So what happens after this tower, after that design comes, is like started? And that is, I think, last week. I can show you what happened in that way. So first, of course, is, let me get it to it, is this kind of announcement because this new the president and this immediately the reaction of to forbid the election system as it has in the local governments. So the next action immediately the day after was this announcement, and so yes, even now with low quality concrete and with 10% of steel, we are going to construct that the next year. So I'm super proud coming back from Jakarta 2 days ago in that way. So what's next in that way? In this stackers environment, we made, this sequence in this 10 years after we started here. Okay, let me bring you to next chapter in that way. Here, this is another one that I can found in that book. And how can we can make, where it is there? Hangers. And, you know, this building we hang one moment in a while ago to have more apartments and have more terraces and have a plaza that continues. So intensity could be made also with hanging. But what's next afterwards? I took you, to Suffolk. This is the landscape in the UK, super cute, beautiful, protected by Prince Charles, And then they had this kind of barns, and the client, Alain de Botton, asked us to make a holiday home, and he said, oh, but he killed the barns. Like, in the second visit, I said, where are the barns? And, yeah, let's get rid of them. And then Prince Charles said, yeah, but you have to make a barn. So there it comes, and here, and I said, no, I'm not coming to make a barn again for you, for all the way from Rotterdam, and you land, and you have to drive for 2 hours, all these roundabouts, I hate them, and then before you come into this site. So he said, maybe, but the barn is too big. That was good, because that it was not allowed by the National Park Service. So we said, okay, we know a solution. The footprint we can reduce while keeping your desire, and the pheasants and the rabbits can just walk underneath your house. And Alain said, and of course it was our answer to happiness of architecture, to keep it a little bit wobbly in that way. And then he said, no, it's too expensive, and people will not come to this house, and because it's a joke, and that remains. Okay, then I drop it. Then what? Long emails, because he writes beautiful books. I will publish it, don't worry. And it's like, and then he, this is also not bad, I said. You fly from the Netherlands, drop a house, and that's it. No, you can't do it. And in the end, he accepted this. So here you see it happening, our discussion, and then it came back, and how we can imagine it. So this is now the house. You don't see it from the road, because it's Prince Charles said you can't do it, and so it should be very, but you come, and ooh, two doors, that's good. Where shall I go to? And they go to the, so, immediately we can eat, or you go to your kids and run like this. You pass by different rooms and end up in this space where you, a certain vertigo is there. There's nature below, on top, left, right, but it's still very domestic. You have elements that are super thick in that way and very British in that way. And then suddenly you look down to your son who is there, and you go around the corner, and then you see the house floating and hovering over this landscape, and where indeed the swing is adding to the maximum, say, distortion of the house. And that compensates a bit my client's happiness in that way. So this is the best, say, nature space that we can give to Britain. Here's the only place where it doesn't rain and where you can have this kind of was the next hangar after the Wozokos in that way. But can we continue? Copenhagen, next example. And what is happening here is that these silos, you know them, and they were like, what can you do with silos? Normally you have this, don't make too much holes in it way, so what you can do is making apartments, these are horrible, to live in such a kind of half pancake, and to with the smallest window. So we see that, let's hang them, let's not put them inside, but put them outside, make small holes only for the doors, and it's easy to do, and that became truth. So here you see the construction, how the houses are suspended, how then they have a complete glass facade, and you can see the surrounding everywhere. And then, I mean, IKEA or Vitra doesn't matter anymore, and that you can love basically any view. And gratuitly, this house gets, say, a kind of a Guggenheim center space for free in that way, and that was basically the advocacy of that. But what is next? And now it becomes interesting, like 2 months ago. What do I see on my mobile in that way? Exclusieve Leijemal in Fremdtidens Noordhavens. What does it mean? Is that there is something exclusively, mind you, exclusively going on. So we take a plane, and what is under construction by an unknown colleague is the purest copy of our enterprise. That is now about what's next, what we are talking about. And this, here we face something that you maybe expect from China, excuse me, but is happening in Denmark. I knew it, that they were a bit weird, and that somehow they think that they are like social, but in the meantime, like Vesten and like the best, say, filmmakers, that is exactly the country. Maybe I could have expected from the south of Spain, but it didn't happen. It was Denmark that did it in the end and made this thing. So we are at the moment in a very beautiful court case. What can we do with that in that way? So what is this issue about? It is in a way, you can, there are many articles and we are now making together where, which is about continuity or not, or discontinuity. These are two buildings and I have no clue which is Zaha and which is mad in that way, in those buildings. We have to wonder how much we want to pay for originality as such, is especially in the Pritzker Prize, important. And in the meantime, what are the fair prices of replicas? Where is the woman of Mies van der Rohe Foundation? This is what we, and of course you know as well very much how that is happening. And these are in our building in Oslo, our colleagues in Rotterdam, my grandfather. This is our building in Paris that comes across. This is something in Singapore by a friend of us. This is our Milano Fair Tower, and here how Bangkok is now erecting, the similar elements. One building that I somehow love, somehow because it's aesthetically marvelous, it is functionally a disaster, and that somehow is also kind of, we work, and I think this is in Taipei with our vertical village is kind of combining. And here I think I find something, because I love what Herzog and Dumeron do, and I'm jealous on what they did. But maybe when I make it urbanistic, I give it an answer in that way, and then it's not only an object, a fetishist object on design, but then it's a tool for reality as such. I'm aware that originality was not always an issue in that way. We have epochs that we were happy to produce this, and at this very moment, we know that originality is very limited in our pockets here in every place. We personalized it, but it's so there is something interesting going on. And at the same moment that Turkey is like copying itself endlessly, this is the new zone of Istanbul, how that's under production, and that we have smart like considerations on that copying is actually not bad. One could say, and that there are examples here in Paris and there the new Aboriginal Museum in Australia that is under, how they produce, and fascinating for Aboriginals to put them in that stack. So what is next on that issue? So there were two elements. We made this magazine where we analyzed basically these deja vus, and this is a very beautiful one, because here seemingly all these architects love a hole. And they, so what is now the best hole, is what they say. Some of them, I love this one from Philippe Desjardins. But, I mean, CCTV, is it that good in that way? And so, I think it's courageous, but we have to find a way to criticize ourselves. And some, that's one thing, and we can improve my uncle or my aunt in that way. And thirdly, we share more than we think. And that we are closer, and a kind of Siam is more on the edge than we want to say. It counts also for the pixel movement that's going over our planet these days, and that that you are staging here in your school as well. So what can we do? This is a nice text that we wrote for Sarkozy, and then you see that some pieces were like killed by the Minister of Interior Affairs, others were done by a ghostwriter. So I love track changes, because track changes somehow indicate like the issue of how progress is like done good track change texts are marvelous and are somehow that's what we can face. So it is like in natural science, somehow I believe and think that architecture can be also like an issue of progress. We need to refer. Come on, guys, it's fine to refer. Because like if I would be a heart surgeon and I would do research on new material, which I will do, and I will show you later, is that I always need to research. And if I don't do that, then my professor career will be ended. So what is the problem out of it? And of course, I take you to our copycat that we do. And this is my village. And this is the proud newspaper of that village, because it is a very ugly village. It is Schijndel, it's next to Flanders, also not the most beautiful part of the world. And then the Americans bombarded my place and killed that place even more over there. So when I was 18, I was like very angry, and I wrote this letter to the mayor, and I said, told him, "Dear mayor, we should do something about it. We have to organize young architects, and I didn't have a diploma, but to make that place better." The mayor was very kind and wrote back this letter. I said, "Yeah, this is Mr. Maas, this is a very nice idea. We thank you for this suggestion, and we come back to you." So that took him 30 years to come back. Then he was still there. He was 70 in the meantime. And he said, yeah, Mr. Maas, you have become a little bit famous and maybe we want you to have back. Can't you make for us a solution? And so, okay, we make you the solution. So this is the old place. Here how the bombardment took it. This is the road, then bang, Americans, then the modernism in a local way. It's nothing. It's like, you can. What can we do here in that space? So this is then the old village, this is the bombardment. So what do you like to make, he said. What is the task? Yeah, I mean, Schijndel, everyone should know Schijndel in the future. And they said, okay, no problem, okay. So you make a skyscraper that somehow say hello to Antwerp and to Rotterdam and to Amsterdam, if not Paris, of course, and then I am here, is what it could be. So here, that would be the best place for Mies van der Rohe, skyscraper from Berlin, to put that in Schijndel and then to make that possible. So he said, are you serious? Yes, I am. Okay, so he put an alderman on top of it, and it started to talk. Okay, the alderman started to work to defend it, and then the village. I mean, oh, poor alderman. After a year, he had to stop his career, and that's architecture. And so, but other politicians in the room, they never want to work anymore with me, because that's the danger of innovation or addressing it. So the mayor said, okay, you get the last chance. So. And now you have to talk with all the politicians, all the parties, 17 parties, eh? The Netherlands. It's not like France where you only have two. No, but 17. So all the 17 have to be there, and one member of every party, and you have every week 3 hours on Thursday evenings, you talk with them about what the building should be. So yeah, what then you ask who the party, what should it be, this big? No. And then this thin? No. Something like, yeah, that's fine. And thick, how thick? This? No. It shouldn't be then thin. No. Yeah, that's fine. And the height then, how high should it be? Like the neighbors a little bit. And the roof, well, yeah. So that was the result. And which is interesting, because if you look to Schijndel, and then you see all these elements over there, which is somehow a kind of very Freudian situation that they want to innovate, but in a way don't. So we started to investigate all these houses, and there are like hundreds of them, and we made here one, we make photographs on that, we digitized it in your perfect manner with our this military way of dealing it, then you have this kind of reductive drawings, then you can calculate the average farm on that way, and we did it for all of them, and then this is the average farm. This is even more interesting, because the average farm is half the size of the bigger volume that they decided for. So we said immediately, taka, that's a good thing. So, because you want to, so you have the door and the handle. Schijndel is big this moment. And is this irony? They asked me, yeah, a little bit, but like the building in Madrid, a certain kind of self. Irony is not bad to help and to overcome the reality that is basically there. So, fine, we agree, but then normal material, yeah, no problem. So what is the material then, like straw, yeah, straw, and tiles, and wood, and bricks, and glass. Glass also, there's no problem. So that's what then you can see happening here. There's the glass building. It's so we photographed all the farms and montaged them together in the average farm. And so that somehow the building becomes the most pure public representation of Schijndel as such. I mean, all the details, and also the ventilation elements, or this kind of, but how to orchestrate them, all this 2,000 panels, and with like 3 gigabytes we are talking about, what is it, 150 dpi, and how to do that in 3 months. So we had to organize render farms in Toronto, Auckland, in Montevideo, etc., in order to get that done in 3 months, and to print it in Japan, So you do something in Schijndel, but actually you do it with the whole world, is what, like you are already expressing this earlier with your students in that way. And then it's, but actually the interior becomes like the softest environment because you're then in the farm everywhere, and it's the largest, say, trompe-l'oeil or the, that we could make. And when you start to cook in that farm, it becomes like, oh, poetic, I would say. Or you're washing your hands in this kind of innocence. Or, I mean, even any type of ugly interior architecture is not a problem anymore, because it's like confronted with that story. And people become, therefore, more cute as such in this environment. And you see them here in this opening act, how the doors are there, how, say, the advertisements are part of it, how the puppets react on our painting, how communication is cheaply done. And when you go up, and this is of course one of the most important details, to make such a window where the continuity is there, and architecture becomes 2 millimeter thick. Wow. I immediately know that in the south, especially in Italy, they will kill this building. They say, how can you do that? And it was also in a debate in Rome a couple of weeks ago. It was like, this is impossible. This is like ridiculous. You cannot say, ironize history. But is it irony? Is this fading aspect between old and new, not the kind of, say, a beauty, where we can look to the city, to the mirror, or to the people at the same moment? And where in the night it becomes a lantern and like an object that wants to advertise Schijndel. And now the mayor is super happy. When that, a month ago from Japan, this delegation came that after the tsunami they wanted to fund architecture somehow that represent history in a village, and that could do that also maybe then in one of the villages in North Japan. They selected 10 buildings over the world and went to there. So you see that, this bus of Japanese coming in and talking with a mayor that doesn't speak any word of English and any word of German, only Dutch, and how proud he is at the moment to get this then further. So that's what's next. But then I'm not stopped, of course, with this issue of copying. I go further now in Amsterdam, where we're asked for quite a known Mark to make his new shop over there on this plot. And the major shopping street of Amsterdam is cute. It has nothing to do with the Paseo de Gracia or something like that. It is a housing street, and then this was the 50s. They started to make some shops in it in a very ugly way, but posh. And now they say, but we want to look a little bit like Avenue Montaigne, because also Prada wants to have 3,000 square meters in this place. And how to do that at that moment? So this is also Giza, and this is what the images they were confronting us with. So then we go back to our cute house, and where this is the old plan in that way, how it looked like in the 1870s, how it has grown over time, how new architects turn it in. This is the horror, this is more dramatic these days, that the architects, they try to be a little bit like history and do it in a little bit modernistic way. Exactly that little bit is horrible. Don't you agree on that? That's kind of, that happens here also, anyway. So what can we do? So we said, no, let's accept. Let's pump it up, because he needs more volume, and then that's the skin. And then we make this building. But only one law, and the mayor went to Schijndel, you see the town, the mayor of Amsterdam go to see it, in glass. So every block, every wood, piece of wood, every piece of architraves or gutters will be made, is on production at the moment in Burano, and turns it into a kind of crystal house. And that somehow, with even the gutters, could be imagined, this is then the house that we make for them. And then it becomes this kind of interior, where also the furniture becomes glass, and everything becomes glass. And then there's of course a question, how intimate can you be? So where the clothes are then designed in mirrors, so that you can touch your body and the view and can go further, and have this kind of direction with the piano and with the, it's kind of, and then continue. We want to have one car and one tram also in glass. We don't manage that yet. And to consider also that the neighboring building would have also the same kind of perspective. So that means that infinity is doable in that way. And but then the question became, this is what it becomes, That is too glass, too much glass. You have to use and accept bricks. I said, I have bricks, glass bricks, real bricks in that way. So, and that is then we calculations. So we started with this. I said, so much like this? Oh, horrible. This? No. So this is what they now accepted somehow in that negotiations, what it could be in that, say, discussion. How big can the first crystal house, we're going to make more, that's a good one, in that, and here you see the tests. How, because this was doable, but to make ceramics with glass with the same kind of glue, oh my God. So here we have to test it and with wooden pieces. So you make a small element. It's not more than how much is it in the end? Say something like 300 square meters of facade we are talking about. And then, but we have to make tests anyway. This is almost like your school that you produce, and how many bugglers can drive their hammer against that building in order to get the jewelry inside. And then that's what you can see in this kind of in elements that we then at that moment research. So yes, there is a what's next in that. But now, I hope to conclude this chapter in the coming 3 months with a badass copy guide. Because that's, of course, that's what you can do then in research, to somehow, look how you can become a star architect in 15 days. And this book has the biggest disclaimer, of course, that you can imagine. And it is composed out of, say, articles by students, about copying in architecture, about law and ethics, obviously, about patents and non-patents, about strategies to live with it, about speed of copying, about evolution of the library. I think that's the most important one that we can address in that way, and that we can learn indeed from others, and that we, and with El Croquis, with your country, we are now, they adopted it, I'm very happy, again, self-criticism, a part of your culture, is coming in with, now we make El Croquet, and where basically we innovate certain kind of things at all the tools, thanks by El Croquis, and where Sana becomes more beautiful in that way, where Rem gets a kind of context, and in this way, where Muji adopts Sana again in that way, where this kind of copycats are, oh man, this is gorgeous to make that building. Why don't we do that? Why aren't you the next step in? This is of course a personal joke, and this is the best, of course, of copying in that way that we could that the students provided for this plan. Then we of course go into SimCity as the best copy element. How to choose in that way, and that I'm not going to show. Because that I will show then in 3 months from now, this is basically an advertisement for that what's next, for that book that comes out and that wants to somehow base itself on the future, as such, on the history, and to perceive a kind of a future as such. Okay, there we go further. Because now there was one chapter that I didn't talk about, two actually, and one is that's urbanism. In that respect. So in the book KM3 10 years ago, we had one chapter on mixing horizontally, and we had a little list of kind of the techniques to do that, to diversify, to give space for the individual, but also to find what is then the collective. I'm not going to show you all of the projects about that, but I take you to Almere for a moment. Here is that, this is Amsterdam, new town, Almere. This is the plan of Almere. Are you living in the green? Was it with different kind of villages? Here how it kind of produced itself with different epochs of beauty as such, and how we continue with that. We wanted to move the garden city diagram to a green city diagram, which is about connections and diversity more than before. And what we do is now making one metro line that goes through it and makes five new garden cities, from one that cleans this lake between Amsterdam with this kind of appearing Atlantis in the coming period, or with this expo that shows itself to Amsterdam, welcome here, to this innovation of the city center so that Rem Koolhaas gets a kind of neighbor in that way, and where this kind of, say, landscape turns into a kind of self, a freedom environment. I'm not going to explain you all, but I will explain you that horizontal, that diversity can be like a fantastic tool to work on it, to give space for everybody. So this is that place, the Floriade, that we are on this heart are making at the moment. We won this competition with the city to make this expo in 2022, which is about horticulture, about garden products, and which I would like to discuss in the programs also with you in that way. So there it is, in the very heart of the city. Now, on the right hand, OMA, on the left side, our forest. And what can we do? If this is the perspective that we have to our ancestors, then I suggest that our ancestors should have this view towards us. And that what we try to do at the moment with this carpet of where, say, we all love plants and in all its means. That means tulips, okay. Wisteria, not bad. Or, oh, this is a cool building. And this could be a beautiful church. Or how to make this kind of hotel. Or this could be a great living environment. That has been done by our colleagues in a way. And we applied that technique now to gradually make a building that they say loving a plant and that turn it in. And then you can have different lovers in that way, where the nymphaea or the forsythia are giving these different buildings. And then, yes, this is the challenge to make a concerto place like this, to make an office like this, to make here a sports place out of it. This would be the best disco of town, and this is of course how we should sleep and bath in green. So these are exercises that adopt one program with one species, and that is like they manipulate it over the site. And we can start with this collection, this arboretum, and then say poop it up where needed and punch it down where we can do it. So to have this, and with this, all these exceptions that are there, to turn it into this loving carpet over in, and how does it look like? This is the plan of that carpet. Basically, these are all the clients that are there, and there are thousands of them. The client is therefore cornus, or it is a bonsai, or it's a betula in that way. And they are confronted with program at that moment. We position them, of course, in a logic way, from A till Z, anemone to zanobia, and then where does the Belgian pavilion then come? Of course, in the B section, that's true. And they are confronted with Berberis at that moment. Where do I put my hotel? And Ash and H is asking us at the moment. Well, you get, of course, you love jasmine. So because then you wake up, so you're in the jasmine sector. And that's how they produce. So you don't see any building. Don't worry. Architects are invited. I will invite you all. There are 100,000 plots, but you won't see you because it's covered by, this is the school, the university that comes in. So there are 800 houses. There's one small university, two schools, and some small office spaces, and two hotels that we can make it in 2022. Not much, I'm aware. It should have been much more. And the forum was much more ambitious, I know. But we see how it ended. So there's in that way, we try to make it modest, but in such a way that this is the boulevard, this is the access, this is the highway, and this is the carpet where we can collect. And now we start this process, the coming time. Now we have to think about, say, buildings that can grow, or that where, say, substrates are part of our building material, not this kind of decoration from the French that we know with Patrick Blanc. So that is what we somehow try to produce in this area in that way. So that's one chapter in this. What's next? The next element is this week in Beijing. I want to show you to a place that you all know. This is Tiananmen. And then, say, there, at that end, that's our new hutong that we are making. If I come closer to that place, then I see this. I see streets that are too big because they are cutaway pieces of the old fabric in that way. And if you go further, then people start to find, like, intensive, this is beautiful that they do in their house, this kind of innovation in that spot. Density comes in, so we drive further, and we see these doors in that way, go further, see this kind of, yeah, what is this? Poverty and on that space. And even the president doesn't know what to do in that zone, and go further and see, even trying to make some renovations, a bit hopeless, I would say. And then still, even the 50s and 70s are in, even the public toilets from Mao are still there, and what to do with that. So we're working with a group of people on this hutong at the moment, analyze basically the growth of the hutongs in the past. That this is the beauty that you know in that way, and this is the richness of the collection of hutongs that have been made, and that leads to this kind of, this is what we love in the Red Lantern at the end of movie. This has led to culture and different kind of desires over time. But what happened, of course, with the hutongs was a certain amount of decay. You all know this picture of this one person that didn't want to leave because he was replaced by this kind of, say, gorgeous architecture that has been made in the last, say, 10 years in that area. So this is what they wanted to dream about. But this is the reality that we have a generation that don't know how to choose from the same, and that somehow we want to replace by more choice as such. So here, Beijing, from in 10 years' time, moving ahead, as it says. Shanghai, similar operation in that way. Seoul, similar direction. And then you can, this kind of Asian cities, this is the diversity in architecture that has been produced. The diversity in the interior, no. The diversity in plants, no. And celebrated by this kind of maps, almost war maps, where in red are the block attacks, and in blue, the defenders, the former hutongs. So from the 30s into the tens, you see this movement going on in Beijing. So we are working on the last hutong somehow. And it's interesting to see that we said that maybe 10 years ago, and with us, more people, that preservation should take a place as such. And that funnily leads in this last in years to a nostalgic comeback. This, thank you to our colleagues, this is the new hutong that is done next door. Or this one by Taiwanese people, where they make streets that are huge and make these replicas of somewhere else. And this is a new river in Beijing at that moment where this is done. Is it old or new? No, it's definitely new. You can see the structure, how it's made, and how it's clad with like Disney kind of elements. And if you go further, I love this image, where suddenly now new hutongs are appearing, competing with that 70s, 80s monster. So what can we do now? Then, and this forms part of a strategy where new neighborhoods are appearing over the planet, where small and big are combined in Le Marais in Paris, or in Greenwich Village in New York, or in the Jordaan in Amsterdam, or some kind of humanity deals with density as such. So how can we do that, from that to that, in this hutong? How can we, something goes wrong, here, have more spacious houses also, or have also much, keep it more green in that. So these are targets, more diversity, also more kind of differentiated incomes in that way, different kind of, say, finance systems, is maybe we could do that. And if you look to the site, then when this was, almost 15 years ago, then this is what happened in those years. They are cutting it through with scissors. I mean, even Damien Hirst wouldn't not have done that into such a kind of environment. So we were thinking, can we then make more high rise in it? So here you see it, how from this we can do it, lift the hutong a little bit up. So here, this is how this density could appear. Or can it become more like a bender, so that we can bend the surface for the shopping mall and have a kind of, like the first Beijing Hill? Or can we do it downstairs, as you can see in this one, and have this kind of beautiful streets in the hutong? Or can we turn it into a new Forum Romanum as such and use it for a green lung? Or do we do a kind of combination of identities that leads to this 1700 puzzle that has been decided? And then the proposal mixes those elements and is a kind of radical love for smallness in a country which is about bigness as such. And then the projects are there. Because we can imagine so kind of scenography of interpretations. The preservation project are there, you can see them, and they are, what do they do? They have different ways of interpreting, by a heritage courtyard, or by this kind of self-evolution showing the history of the courtyard house. Or we have an interpretation zones of others that could be done and are now selected, where there are people that will want to make a silhouetted, more like glasshouse courtyard, or a complete, say, rebuild, or this kind of block, or that kind of printed courtyard could be imagined and lead to this kind of beauties at that moment in that zone. Or the identity project. Some others wanted to show them a little bit better And so we do this with the community, basically, to make these monomaterials, or that the brand one, or the mirrored one here on the left, so that, this is a very beautiful one, because it's a mirage at the moment, and where this mirrored courtyard comes alive, or the edge project, but how to finish. And that way, restore the roads, make go to the edge, but keep it in a kind of transparent way. So they can continue the project, but it has to be out of glass towards these edges. And that's what you see with the trimmed, the billboards, and leads to this kind of roads again. And of course, the greeners are there. Basically, a composition of the municipality and of certain kind of, say, investors that want to make a Pompeii over there, or like a trimmed topiary elements, and this collection that we could make. And on the riverside, this kind of courtyards will work on an interpretation of the water system in different ways, and suddenly we can make this kind of floating courtyards and floating houses over in that area. And the passages, those that need some kind of shortcuts for shopping, gets this kind of cut-throughs in that zone, or the infillers, where we somehow add program in the courtyard, on top of the courtyard, and then you get this, or Buckminster Fuller comes alive. Or the vertical ones, the advertisers, more density, or even erecting is what it wants to do in different ways. And this is funny, because this one was so loved the last weeks that not only one, but there are now four of them that want to have this kind of element. And the diggers are in it. And so there you can see how that can lead also to a beautiful house in that way. The ones that dedicates itself to parking in different components, you see the different structure. I love this one, how you can drive in the flipping house, and how the amenities are adopted by courtyards. From the markets towards the library, like an holographic courtyard, and the sustainable ones that provide energy and food in different ways lead to this kind of courtyards. Now in the coming 5 years, I hope to stage this kind of expo of 1,700 projects, 1,700 programs, 1,700 owners, and similar amount of architects and artists. That show that, yes, a grand collection can be there, and that right next door to Tiananmen, that we can make this kind of super Chinese collection that show itself to the world, and that's monitored in this way. And yes, of course, the phasing, but that's peanuts, and that's not interesting to show at the moment, that we'll do the next time. And what is then we have a next hutong, and then you go over this hutong, you see the bikers, the farmers, you see the school, you see the cutters, you see the leisure, you see the verticalists, and that leads to this kind of dream. Indeed, the next hutong comes alive. And what's next? Go now to this exhibition in Beijing, where these elements are hanging above you, and you can see the future of that hutong. You can climb the walls and go and see what this hutong can be as a kind of advertiser of the beauty. And that is what I would say of the what's next. Now, last chapter, then you can go for the party. And because I didn't say anything about research. And obviously, that is a part of the element of today, that somehow we should also talk with your institutes on. So I close this book for a moment. Done. And what is the next after this? That's basically KM4, which is about time, that I would like to do. Where is Akhtar in the room? Because we have to make that next chapter. So the Y Factory is basically an answer, like you are doing, and we are that way brothers and sisters, on a moment to reflect and to make and to produce models of the future. Somehow we do the same, but otherwise we are very different. And I think that's we have to discuss it over the planet, that we don't copy each other, but collaborate in the best way. So this is our first place, maybe you remember it, the dean went away, and then he gave this place to us, we did a carpet, and then the people came in, then this is a view from my house 2 weeks later, I come back, hey, that's my department, there it goes down, I have to open up the office, the studio on the roof over there, then we go into our office, then we rent tents, rebuild a place that you can see here, pump up a roof, and then put this tribune in it to stage the Y Factory and to discuss with people and produce elements and discuss that also with our ministers and our financiers. That's what it is. That is the beauty. That's what you have to enlarge even more. So this is then the sequence that we produce. And this is a way how to discuss specialisms between school also. Because here we only concentrate on future cities. And there are three elements to look at it. Because the models are changing one parameter on an abstract city, say sky cars, that's now in fashion this last weeks, and then the whole city will change. In the viewing section, we do that by applying it on a site, and in the controller is ultimately the library, is an interactive where all these parameters, yes, parametric design is good, no worry about that. Let's keep the discussion for the next 20 years out of our hours, and we put that in that space fighter. So we made some books, and here you see how we studied the visionary and looked at how much has been produced the last 100 years. And how much is not done since the 70s. And we called about indeed thinking, and that is, of course, what you are trying to attempt also, to give a direction to. Leadership is something we have to work on. And it can be on many subjects in that way. You do some of it, and what can be in the future city? The issue on solitariness is basically happening in our zones, with our concentration on our virtual domain. That means that basically we can produce this kind of cities without any problem. Or the issue of the miniature is coming up in the bottom-up generation that we are facing at the moment. But and that you can see then, when we study that, well, this is wallpaper of the last 5 years. Only cuteness is there. And then what is happening with this shit? Don't we comment on that? So somehow this cuteness needs to advertise on something. Or the iconic, another one. I mean, this colleague has ruined my career. And because he got so much money to make this sameness everywhere, and all his mayors wanted to have a piece of him, and this collectionism has killed indeed a lot of our generation. And then another colleague, the hairdresser among us, he did it in the same way. So that means, are we going to get rid of the word icon? No, we should not. Because somehow we have to think about the world, we have to think about things that slightly go ahead and that are adventurous, and then they become iconic. We have to rephrase the word iconic and build up a criticism of what leadership can be. That is what that, and of course the word re is stupid. That is, we should kill immediately, because this is re, this is the Netherlands in that way. And when you talk currently in our academic domain, then re, imagining, re-studying, but in a way this shows the cycle of what we are doing. This shows but it's a cycle that hopefully is a spiral that brings us up in that way. So we have to comment that re-ness in a productive way. And the future is in, and you have explored that, and we should find that more because there's a market in that. And as you can see with the matrix and how much that has been sold in only about future, then that, yes. That's what we can symbolize with the future. It's a mirror of the existing, and Boulez that I started with has been inversed into from an inside to an outside. And then you continue with another way of observing green, another parameter. And the green dream was about that, when we showed in 22 ways. Why 22? Because there were 22 students. And that is fine. And that and everyone is studied like behaviorism on Mr. Green in that way. And these students were fantastic because they found out that all green buildings are basically ugly, except of yours. But that's in that. But why? Because they're only add-ons. They're not integrated, or they're incredibly cliché, or they're about very reductive. We can't make glass. The Mies van der Rohe Pavilion is the last building that could be built in glass almost, or it will become very expensive. Vous savez, or that basically we can do it, and the rest of the money goes to the roof. And so then there is an observation on complexity in that way. And there is a kind of attempt to make them to get all this in a kind of calculator to improve these kind of laws that are there. There are about 1,002 laws in the world about Mr. Green, and they don't talk with each other. I mean, Braham and Leed are like two separate worlds. And so we have to bring them together in a kind of new Esperanto. We have to bring in larger scale also to make that possible. And then we can make the greenest city. That's this one. That beats Masdar at that moment. And that's kind of but yeah, that doesn't sell. So using patterns, and as some of you are using in the past, enlarge them is what we try to do. This is one beautiful example that I especially took for you today to your city, because this is crop rotation. And crop rotation, as you know, and you are going to study that the coming year, I guess, is a fantastic product to enlarge our consumption pattern. So imagine our own production pattern. So imagine that we do that crop rotator on our roofs. Then Barcelona would be great. And then suddenly I would give an answer to your colleagues and to make a very self-sustainable. Wasn't that the wish of your mayor to do that? Now here you have a project for him. Or this one, also a thing that you are studying, the new plasmas that can create light with certain temperature and certain chemicals. That means basically that the water can transform into a machinery of light. You try to do that also, we share that. So here you see, share like an obsession with how poetic it can be. And this is a funny one, the professor in Braunschweig made this collector, but very cute, and these students enlarged it and turn it into this imagery of sun collectors, won a prize, and have now a big patent, and now they're rich, these three guys, because they can build it in Hong Kong, and with images that beat Avatar. And here, boredom becomes suddenly beautiful. So how more beautiful you can make Mr. Green, the better it is, because then we can accelerate, and then green is over in like 5 years from now. Nice what you did, but we have to speed up a little bit in order to get rid of it. And then we can talk again about architecture, about social elements, about economy, and all those other elements, what now is impossible. So what's next in that way? This is the latest project in that way, the biodiversity project, where our clients are animals, partly for the Floriade. And a calculation, if I have like a mouse, how much rabbits do I need, how much goats, how much wolves in order, and how much space that costs is our triangle of desire. And then products, yes, this is what I mean, also happening here, can help to turn it into urbanism. Here the tramway system of Amsterdam, designing other kind of railway system, and suddenly you have new biotopes, you have new guys that want that are looking forward to this rails. So that is what architecture can do. These bricks, I love these bricks because they absorb all the sound that is thinkable in that way, which causes a city, like when the first snow is fallen, whispering city, so beautiful. But in the meantime, bats love that and will come to that. And then suddenly, this is our focus, of course, with the orphanage in Amsterdam, to cover it with that kind of holes, so that suddenly you have this kind of beauty back into that. And what is then next to that? And I bring you to two enterprises, where it is, sorry. Give me 5 minutes and I'm done. Yep, there it is. Somehow, and some of you know this project, the Porous City is like, I started with KM3 with opening up the city. But porosity is ultimately a space that we give for things that we don't know. So to dedicate then one of the projects to that is simply talking about density that's produced or reproduced by this kind of stupidity, by towers that have one entrance go up and go down and that's it. And it has to deal with phasing and how we deal with economy. So the project is done with Lego, and to say this is our desire, opening it up in that way. And that somehow we asked every student in this MSc class to make one thought on opening up. So here this one is about a pregnant woman that opens itself a little bit and then create a kind of step by step this kind of open space. Or the splitters that are here that investigate thinness in the end, how much can we afford. Or the twisters that turn it into this kind of environment. Or the bubbles that make neighborhoods like that. I didn't know what students could come out of it. Here, the cactus guy that made this kind of beautiful test, how far he could go with the cactus thought. Here also the splitter, not a splitter. So there are many sequences. Yeah, this was, he got low ranking. But this kind of alphabet that was too simple. But anyway, there were many of them that somehow, the balcony series were made sense to maximize it, or the balls that give one, say, space, or the randomizer, even, or the deviator, or the landscape maker, the parasites, that led to this kind of sequence with this flipbook, and then this kind of, say, Xi'an army of towers that are represented by this, and where you see the different area, there are the pregnant series is over there, or you can see in this case here, Solovit has makes sense at that moment, or the ball series that flattens out the balconies that go around, or this is my favorite, the one that bends, the most polite tower on the, I would love next to Jean Nouvel here in Barcelona to make this to my, but actually it is a stair to heaven, and we use the apartments to go, and we have to compensate it. I mean, someone will copy it, don't worry, it's open source these days, so we are happy to do that in that case. So here you see the different examples appearing as such in this kind of army. So this was like an intuition turned into scripting, into analysis afterwards what it can be. So we did the inverse from post-scripting to pre-scripting, which leads to, as you do also, and like in this case, if you make a stair program for a tower, and these are the parameters that are indicated, that are connected in this series, you see them in a section, how they lead to the possible gems in stories to make these stairs, and actually, oh, it's quite good, this tower. I wished that we would, that the Torre from Nouvelle would have done this, because then I could have climbed it in an Escher-like way from the bottom to the top as such. Or here the landscape group that made this starting point, started to combine them and connect them, and then you get this kind of, say, when the structure comes in, like these grottos interconnected with each other, where everyone is like looking into this kind of collective space. What a beauty. And so that could continue with all this kind of, say, enterprises that we made in this kind of, say, pre-scripting act, and then they're shipped around and examined and showed over the world. So what's next afterwards? You can also apply this methodology on the urban terrain. When, say, Ungers was a kind of cute in those days, and now what can we do the next step in that way? You see some of them, of the typologies that we have in Europe to make good urbanism as such. So let's use that as a starting point for transformations. With a similar floor area ratio, how would it look with when you do a patio system and then improve the patio system that everyone has sun? Or when this patio system would look to a kind of, say, a diversification act and leads to these grottos. Or when this kind of street system is multiplied ultimately to a slabs that are diversified because of sun reasons. Or a tower system that is splitted in order to activate more like corner rooms and more views as such. So even thinner towers could then start to help each other and lead to this kind of environment. Or where pyramids can get more sun angles and leads to this crystalline environments. Or ultimately, this kind of thinness lead to new kind of atomiums in our cities. And then we can evaluate them on the numbers of voids, on the numbers of terraces, distances, surfaces, two views, sunlight on different angles. And then we can see if a certain kind of, say, the patio, your favorite block, how an improved courtyard can, the greater courtyard can do, and by measuring it, how both money-wise. And then you see what innovation, what's nextness can be done in that way, in for any typology that we could imagine in the urban world. And of course, we can notate the moments that they go from one element to the other. And then we ask students to make all these products and to see them then and to test them again on the ground and see the qualities of those spaces, of the different, say, new typologies that we could imagine and dream about based on that, say, porosity discussion that we can imagine in our future cities. So what's next then? And now I need you. Because every student needs, I need three students, 3 weeks, day and night, to make one tower and one element. You can't do that. That's forbidden. This is like kids' labor in that way. And so, can I be sued as a professor? Is then the question. So this is what we did with Greg in that way, Lynn, and with one of the robots to put pressurized Lego blocks on top of each other, and this is what you can do here. And that's with your machine. And then basically architecture become this, like scripting, simply Grasshopper and Rhino. It's not so complicated. And then make these patterns, and that is knowledge, in a way, what you are wanting to do and what we can imagine. So what is the next? And of course, practicalities come in. It is buildable. We have to invent. Now we calculate how a deviation on this base, how we can calculate the amount of steel that we need to do in order to have this deformation from that to that. And then we can show how all these blocks are, and that will come out now very soon. And then you have this device to make also this porous city then thinkable. And now the very end. In that way, it is. I want to culminate, of course, like you do, a little bit with what is then the ultimate next step. This is Barba Papa. Barba Papa is a project that we do with Akzo Nobel, and which is called the transformer, and it's based on CHO molecules, somewhat stiffeners that you have, and it aggregates and it can de-aggregate. Is basically the function. So if you have this kind of aggregate or de-aggregates. And then this is the dream that you are also like to do, and that you need to explain it more explicitly, I would say, and more like wider. It is that, okay, then we can pull out this washing basin in the future. Wash our hands, because water comes from anywhere in this kind of substrate that we are making. Or chairs. The whole ideology of Mies van der Rohe chairs, the copy-paste, is no problem anymore. Because yes, your printing facility, no, your stabilizing printer makes this chair anyway. Or windows industry, where are you guys? That we have to deal with you how this kind of silicate can be made in that way. And that will change our habits. Yeah, this is a couple that watches television in that moment together and then go to bed together. Then you don't need the rest of your house, is what the students are saying. And when they raise and they have a shower and then they close the house in the end and they go away to their office, then the house can shrink. And the office grows in that time because more people are coming and more discussions are held, adapting to its site, and then you get this kind of leisure in between and go further to the parties in the evening, and then the office can shrink again because the nightlife is taking place at other places. And that of course is not only you, it's also your neighbor that is doing that, and then you can see this kind of reactions happening every second, every minute in this neighborhood, in this city, ultimately what happens. And is this imaginable? And then I look to one slide that the students produced at a certain moment in this one. This is gorgeous. How to make a lift in that way. Where is Otis in the room? And then they can, because what it is also like when you go to IKEA and throw your kit in the bubble bath over there, the other kids do only this because it's no problem. It dampens out. I mean, there's so much more with that matter than we now think, and to turn it into a new city. So how can we then go further with this research is then a question that you also have here on this in the school. And how can one group go bring it to the next step? This group in Zurich made a film, and every student made a 2 seconds or 3 seconds of pieces of the film. And they make questions what that material to Akzo Nobel to ask them what should that material do. So here you see it, it's a bit Leni Riefenstahl, I'm aware. A beautiful body, he sleeps, and he only needs that space. This halo is basically what we need. He wakes up and there is kind of, oh, what is this? I need more, I can go up. And then like in Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times, the material pushes you up. That's okay, that's a quest. How can we do that? Can you do that the next time for me? And then of course you are raised and then you want to have space before you. And I think it was an interesting moment of this group of students because they started to walk and say, what is the space that I need before? And when does the space behind me stop, go away, fade away, and what memory is still over there? This is a memory part I want to look up, but there's another one that if I want to go then to infinity and I want to make a window, this is always the nicest moment, that you do this kind of gesture and then the window opens itself. So you see our guy doing it, and then any window can be produced. So again, just make that then in the next research possible. So I need a half a year of research again with 20 students in order to make these windows, is what these students have been discussing and suggesting. So this is also nice. See, my son comes with his dog, and of course we want to meet. So pop, how to do that, Mr. Axo Nobel, is what is said. How can we do that? Or this one, this group was also fantastic. Water, pneumatic water, like how does that work? Like your heartbeat. Can that material do that? And then water can be everywhere. Lower, higher, again for my son in that way. And of course, it makes these dreams possible. I can swim wherever I want. Okay, there it is. And because the water collects immediately, this is a project on itself. Bathtubs are fantastic elements to design. And how to do that in that way. Of course, there's light. That's an easy part to do, like a sun. But I love this because this section, because it's like in a gym, and when you walk on a bath, who is moving? Is the water moving? Are you moving? Is the material moving? That is, I think, ultimately the future, that we don't know exactly where speed and space meet each other, as many scientists are already studying. My son in science is doing. The best bathtub for Peter Zumthor is then made by another student, of course, Swiss. Oh, this one is nice, a Belgian group. Worked with Dirk Bickenbergs on like fashion. And it's very primitive still, because that will happen now more in that shop that I was showing. So clothes come to you, but actually clothes, you can design any piece of stuff that goes around it, from, say, the Baroque to recent elements that could be imagined. So the film is therefore very bad. You can see also mistakes, because this is the issue that we exactly have to show. So next questions appear in that way. And I have dressed myself, now I want to cook, and there the material comes. So the supply chain for Walmart should be done in this way, or a heating device, the molecules to heat them up is already much more doable. I think you are partly doing that. And then to get this kind of, say, cooking devices, and this kind of, say, changeability of this is already fantastic to do with Bulthaupt. One kitchen that transforms from cooking into sitting is what we are asking to do. And I come to that because then this continues, and I will stop about it, is how to continue with that. So the next step is building here in the Kunsthal this felt room to test how a combination of felt, a chicken wire and felt, can transform and turn it into different, say, stitching acts in that way. How we currently, some PhD students are working on Muybridge, because it analyzes perfectly your movements and the fading out of that process. And that can be then mirrored to the front side of your body, so that it becomes applicable and memorized if needed in that way. The Magic Carpet Project, this is the sequence with Vitra and Cartel. And this is so beautiful because here are two students. How old are they? 21. And you see them happening here. So they made this desire to have a 2x2 piece of carpet, and then that can transform into anything that you would like. Yes, a table. Very primitive, but I think gorgeous. And you saw this film, because this film helped Cartel immediately to give that, say, research money now to make it possible in the coming study year, and to have, say, this kind of sleeper. But how to do that? So thick layers of felt in combination with programmable composition of chicken wire will start to do that. And then we have to start small. So this is a project financed by a rich Swedish lady close to Stockholm, who gave some budget to make a small piece. So we did two pieces for her, and they're hanging in her castle at the moment. So there's a first thing, what can you do then with this kind of material when you have motors inside and you start to act and react on its manner? So if I do this, just by distance, and you know it because you study it also. How can this felt then react is what this talking napkins are doing. But the soft wall is, say, the next enterprise. So you step from a napkin then to a wall and ultimately to a floor, and then, yes, maybe I can make a Barba Papa house, is what it wants to say. So here you see how this is the samples of how motorized felt could be react. That's kind of nice and sensuous. But it becomes more interesting if the interaction is then somehow staged, as you do here in this institute. So So there are different tests to be imagined, and that everyone takes about a month to do with its specs and its materials. This is, we need about 1,000 of these elements. Everyone costed like 40 euros, so you imagine you know the budget. Greek guy. Very sensuous. And I start to yell. And it's interesting to say what words, like in your voicemail or what in your iPhone, would help ultimately to react on this movement, is what this study is doing. So please go to Stockholm to see them. So yeah, what's next then? So everything you make has a next step. And every maximization, because that's what the state of art is in that way, leads immediately to a need to improve and to encourage a next step in that way. And that maybe is then a sinusoid that is the best way that I can make, define KM4 in the nearby future that I hope can come out in this city that that has a history with me and that somehow faces also your reality here at your institute. And with this, I hope to show you our work and somehow to inspire you the coming year to make the best products and to compete with us in the best manner. I thank you very much for this long lecture.